Now we are going to see that by what we mean by convex function. We stated it in the last class that a convex function is the one which at any given point I can get a lower bound on it, right? Basically that lower bound came from a tangent which passed through any given point, and that tangent was defined in terms of the subgradients at that point w that you are interested in. So that function, the tangent function that was like a lower bound, it was to my function all the time. But now if we allow ourselves bit more flexibility, that the gap between that convex function and my linear function, if it is like slightly good, big enough, it grows well, then we will have a better control over regret. Okay, so let us first define then what is that strongly convex function is. So we are going to say, so this is the definition of my convex function, strongly convex function with parameter sigma. So you see that this is the part which you have already defined. We know that a convex function, this part already holds, right? If you have a convex function f, in fact we have said that function f is convex if and only if this part holds, where z is the subgradient of your function f computed at point w. And this part here, this is basically a tangent which is passing through your point w, okay. But now what we are saying is, yes, this was my initially my lower bound on the function, but in addition to this, if I add this extra factor to this, that is I have increased my lower bound by this much amount, then also this entire thing continues to hold, be a lower bound on my function f. And notice that what is this part here? So this is at point w you are computing the tangent. If you increase u, that is if you are moving away from omega, this guy is only increasing. So basically if you look this difference between f of u minus f of w, this guy is like also growing. So in a way what we are doing is, so suppose like let us say this is my convex function, and if I had taken some w, so this is like f of w z minus v, and also what I want now is this term here, sigma by 2 norm of u minus w. You see that this gap between this function and this, at any point let us take, so let us say this is w, this is w, and you take any other point at some point, let us say this is to be u. If you now look into the difference of your function, this is let us say f of u and this is like f of w. You now look into the difference between f of u minus f of w, f of minus w, earlier that difference was only this much, then it was simply a convex function. Now it is also growing by this much. So if you are going to take u away from omega, so you expect this gap to be also be enlarging, right? So in a way, in that, in this case, the separation between this and this line. So maybe I just don't want this. If you just take this line, so this gap is also kind of growing very fast, and growing means at least by this amount. Okay, and this has to be. So this is F, and this is any point W. So this kind of this portion is like norm of U minus W square. Okay, this is, I'm not saying like whatever the norm you have given, I want this to be, take that and square it. Okay, so this is whatever the norm, this is defined with respect to some norm, and I want the square of that norm, and this is what it is, right. So what we basically, by bringing this sigma strong convexity, we are basically wanting the separation to be growing much faster. In this way, it will become easier for us to kind of possibly to identify these functions. Okay, so now let us have some more properties of this strongly convex function. Okay, first thing is what we call, so this is another lemma I am going to call it as. Now let, instead of taking some every point W, let us take a specific point W which is like a minimizer of this convex function. Then for all U equals to S, we have this U of S minus F of W is going to be sigma by 2 times norm of U. So what we are now saying, that instead of looking at this omega, where is, let us say this function is getting minimized here. Okay, take this point. And now look at the tangent which is basically passing through this, let us say like this. Okay. Now we are saying that if you are going to look at the difference of your function, like let us say this, basically this difference, that is f of u minus f of w, this is growing like this. This will be at least, this difference is going to be at least this amount, right. So if, so this property is one thing, because at any, when we are going to deal with our kind of minimize at every point, when we are finding WT in my algorithm, right, we will be looking at the minimization of some convex function. Okay, so there this maybe result will be useful, like when I am going to look at this point, how it is, how was the value of the other points going to differ with respect to this value. Okay, fine. Again, so just to argue, so here we really don't need to assume that this result holds for a function f that is differentiable. This function need not be differentiable at any point. Okay, but let's try to understand this, why this statement holds for the case where my function is differentiable. Okay, at all the point. So what we know about this, suppose if W is my minimum value of my function f, what will be the gradient at this point? It is going to be 0, right. So then in that case, if I take this W to be the minimum value, and in that case this is a just like gradient at that point, right? And that will be 0. So, in that case, this z is a 0 vector. So, if you just plug in 0, what will be left it only? This term, which is like a lower bound in this case, okay. But as I said, it need not be just true for the case where my function is differentiable. When it is not differentiable, if when only my subgradients are there, this is fine, okay. Fine. What is the how to check that my function is then strongly convex? Okay, fine. What is how do you check your function is convex? That is the definition. Okay, you can directly see whether that definition holds. Then you can check your. Are there any tests for convexity? Yeah, second derivative, if it is a real function, if its arguments is real, then you can differentiate with respect to that argument and see whether its second derivative is positive or not. But here we are talking about convex function which was taking vectors as inputs, right? Here what is your test? Yeah, Hessian, right? And what is that what should be the property of that Hessian? Right. So, whatever, like what you want, it should, we want it to be positive semi-definite or right. So, if it is strict, fine, otherwise we need my Hessian should be positive semi-definite or positive definite, whatever you want. Now, is there an analog test for this? What is the test? So, the test for that is take the Hessian and so, take the Hessian at omega and then if it is going to be greater than or equals to sigma times this, then you can verify that your function is sigma strongly convex with respect to this norm. So, here I have defined this x, this is with respect to some norm, right? If it satisfies this property with respect to some norm, then we are going to be, and this is like a test. In that case, we know that this definition holds. Because of that, it is sigma strongly convex with respect to that norm, okay. Okay, now let us see, I think earlier I made a mistake with respect to that Euclidean regularization. Okay, now let us see whether this property holds for Euclidean regularization. So, what is our Euclidean regularizer? We said that R of omega is 1 by 2 and I am just keeping the eta term here, it is the Euclidean regularizer. So, now let us try to work out what will be its second Hessian looks like. What is its second Hessian? So, what this matrix look like? So, this is delta 2 R omega, delta omega 1, delta omega 2, like this, right. So, then this is delta 2 R omega. So, maybe I will fix W 1. So, this is sorry, this is W 1 and this is W 2 all the way up to delta omega 1 up to and delta, let us say there are d components in this, this is like this. And the last one is going to be delta of r omega times delta omega d delta omega 1 all the way up to delta square. So can you tell me if compute, like if I take this r omega to be like this, what is this values are going to be? So 2 is getting knocked off here, right? It is just going to be identity function. Okay, now identity times a matrix, it is going to be x itself, right? And now x into x, and now I am interested in, I have already specified this function r with respect to Euclidean, that is L2 norm, right? So I would now see that with what, whether this guy is again going to satisfy this property with some Euclidean, L2 norm. So in this case, what I am going to get? This I am going to get x comma x, and what is x comma x in a product? It is going to be, right. Now my Euclidean regularizer here is strongly convex, but that is not a complete description, right. It is strongly convex, what sigma? So it is, what we have shown is Rw is one strongly convex with respect to L2 norm. So if you have shown it to be strongly convex, one strongly convex, maybe we messed up when we tried to see that this guy was Lipschitz, or it should be still fine. So anyway, please do verify whether still, like, we have left it. We said that this is Lipschitz, but we didn't complete that, right? So just go and verify this, whether this is a Lipschitz. If yes, with what value of L? Okay, fine. So at least now we know that this guy is anyway convex, but it is more than that. It is strictly convex with respect to the L2 norm. Okay, this is one regularizer we have. I am going to discuss with you today one more regularizer called entropy regularizer. So how many of you heard about entropy function? You heard it where? With machine learning. Is there a difference between entropy and cross entropy? We are talking about cross entropy, not entropy, right? What is self entropy? Okay, so we will revisit this a bit later, but let me write it. Cross entropy. Okay, or, and you are also using the word KL divergence. And so you are just throwing in many random terms, or you know about them. Okay, we will discuss this later, but just like to be KL, it is called KL divergence, or like you also want to call it cross entropy. Okay, before I write it, the way we are updating this W's, right? W's are what? They are coming from my set U, because I am trying to minimize my function over U, right? Suppose let us say that is a convex function. when I consider this linear function, when my losses are linear, what was my W T happened to be every time? It was just like a average of all the W's. Sorry, it was average of all the gradients, right? Right. If I assume that these gradients are coming from a convex set, so their average is also, it is also some convex valued, right? But were the W's, were they a probability vector? The W's, the weights I am getting in every round, WT, how did I obtain? WT was like, okay, so after simplification, all the things, WT plus 1 was WT minus eta ZT, right? So ZT was not in my control, that was chosen by the environment or the adversary. So here WT plus 1 is, can you guarantee it to be a probability vector? It need not be, right? Why it has to be? It can be any value. Okay. But so if I want to cover the cases where my W's has to be kind of probability vector, right? Then maybe like if I am going to use such an update rule, this WT will not be probability vector, continue to be probability vector. But if you now recall, go back and recall your prediction with expert advice, what were W2s there in every round? They were probability vectors, right? You actually derived, you made them to be probability vector in every round. So if you have this kind of regularizer which yielded in such kind of updates, you are not going to get probability vectors in each round. And because of that, you will not be able to generalize or recover the prediction with expert setting with this convex functions. So you remember how we are getting all this, we just pitched this convex online optimization as a generalization of all the prediction with expert advice, right? So this online convex optimization that way should also cater to the case where prediction with expert advice algorithm setting is recovered. But in so far we are not able to do that because these WTs are not there. But suppose you want to restrict your W2s to be always to be a probability vector, then what kind of regularizers you will be interested in applying? Then comes all this scale divergence, cross entropy, because these are all make sense when you are dealing with probability vectors, right? Okay. Now let's say this is between two vector, two probabilities. I am going to call this as P and Q. So P is one probability vector and Q is another probability vector, both defined on the same spam sample space. Okay, then I am going to define this to be pi log pi divided by qi. Let us say my sample space has some n elements in it, or maybe not n, maybe we will use some k elements in this. It's fine. And then if you simplify this, I can write it as So can I simplify this in terms of this? So So, notice that this part here only depends on the pi distribution, whereas this part depends on both pi and qi here, okay. So, this part here, that is pi log 1 pi, this part without this minus 1, we are going to call this function as entropy. And we will discuss this later. This is kind of how much information is contained when you generate a symbol according to this distribution, okay. So, that is fine. Now, you are interested in this kind of regularizers. Okay, and that is what I mean by entropy function, entropy regularizers. So, I am going to define my R of omega to be Wi log of simply Wi. Let us say it is over some d number of rounds. This is another one. So, right now I have not said this W has to be a probability vector, but let us say this is any vector W, then I am going to define my entropy functions to be like this, okay. So, now let us say, now we want to see, is this, what kind of function is this? Is this R of W? Is it a, is this strongly concave, sorry, strongly convex? If yes, with what sigma and with what norm? Okay. So, can we see that? But now, let us say I am taking this omegas to be coming from all my x in Rd such that my xi's are positive for all I 1 to d and my summation of xi is equals to 1. What now I have made is, what is this? Okay, let me call this omega coming from belonging to S, which is defined like this. So, what is this S? It's a semicircle. Is this a semicircle? I am saying all the, if I take a vector, all its components are positive and they sum to 1. It is a simplex, right? It is a probability simplex, right? So, more generally what I can write instead of defining like this, probability simplex, yeah, probability space, or what you just call it, probability, okay, if you do not want, let us call space. Okay, so, I want to just generalize this, instead of like this, I am going to define S to be all x all xi components are positive and the L1 norm of this is bounded by B. So, what I have done, this is like special case of this when I said B equals to 1, and what is L1 norm of this? L1 norm of x is what? Summation of xi's. But it is not simply summation of xi's, it is summation of mod of xi's, but we have already ensured that xi's are positive, so I do not need to put my mod there. Now, if I am going to define my r of omegas like this, and where my omegas are coming from this space. Now, what about this? Is it any strongly convex function for some parameters? Okay, so it so happens that r is 1 by b strongly convex. So, I have specified what is sigma, then what is the norm? It is going to be strongly convex with respect to L1 norm. Okay, I will leave this you to check this. So, how you are going to do this? Again, you just go and compute the Hessian and see whether this guy is going to be greater than or equals to 1 by b times L1 norm squared. Okay, fine. So, we have basically now defined two regularizers which are both strongly convex, but in two with respect to two different norms. Your Euclidean regularizer is strongly convex in L2 norm, your entropy regularizer is strongly convex in L1 norm. Okay, so that is fine. We will see how considering these regularizers in different with respect regularizers which are strongly convex in with respect to different norms, how does this affect. So, fine, let us come back to just regularize having a strong convex functions. Okay. Now, what we will show is, and also we will be interested in functions which are Lipschitz now. Okay. Now, what we were interested in follow the regularized leaders with strongly convex functions. Okay, maybe I'll just state the result and we'll look into this proof in the next time. So this. If we have this, if I am going to apply my follow the regularized reader with strongly convex functions, this is what we will get. So I am now just stating that what is the role of strong convexity of my regularizers in the bounds we are going to get when I am going to apply my follow the regularized reader algorithm, right. So remember we had terms like this when we had follow the regularized regret. We needed to bound the difference of the function f t in round t at the point w t and w t plus 1. Now if my function f t is already Lipschitz, this holds already, right. But now further we are going to say that if my regularizer R is strongly convex, this can be upper further bounded as L t square by sigma. Sorry, this is also L t here, this is also L t here. So this part is obvious, the first one, the second one is coming from the strong convexity of my, okay. So just what is the statement we are saying? You take a regular function R which is strictly convex function for with respect to some norm, and now take assume that this F t is to be Lipschitz and that Lipschitz constant is L t for function t again with respect to the same norm. Okay, so you have to, because we need to specify the norm, we are saying that these are specified with respect to the same norm, and if your algorithm is predicting this w1 w2 then this is the bound. So in the next one we will show this and see that how this helps in getting the bounds for both kind of regularizers.